Dr. Phil Hoskins from Kingsport, Tennessee. Brother Phil is former pastor of Higher Ground Baptist Church, at one time one of the fastest growing churches in the Southern Baptist Convention. He retired a couple of years ago. Now he travels all over the country preaching the Word of God. Now imagine, he goes outside of the country as well, preaching the Word of God. He told me what he's going to be sharing tonight. I absolutely cannot wait, so I'm not going to take up any more time. Brother Phil, you be coming right now, and as we always say, just preach the Word.
I think I got it on.
All
right. Am I on? Okay. Man, I was thrilled to hear those amens, because I was in a church recently in a pretty large metropolitan First Baptist Church in a revival meeting, and I preached Sunday morning, Sunday night, Monday night, didn't hear one amen. Not one. And I thought, I've heard better preaching, but I've heard worse preaching too. And surely I could get one amen out of Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Monday night. And so on Tuesday night, I just gave it my best shot. And is this one of those churches, Pastor, where nobody smiles? Nobody laughs. Nobody says amen. Oh, you wouldn't dare raise your hand and praise the Lord in that church. But Tuesday night, I gave it all I had. I thought, they're not going to grunt. So I just stopped preaching. I really did this now. I stopped preaching, walked down off the platform, sat down on the front row, and just real loud hollered, amen. And went back up on the platform and said, you First Baptist folks here tonight need to understand that if I'm going to have to do the preaching and the amening, it's going to take twice as long to get out of here. Guess what? The amening picked up at the First Baptist Church. I can tell you that. So, but I am thrilled to be here, and the singing has been phenomenal. And I had no idea that the Rock Springs Trio was going to be here tonight. But ladies, you all did awesome and blessed me. And the choir, I've been in churches run 1,000 that doesn't sing like you folks do. And that blessed me. Amen. And I thank you. So you all keep smiling and keep saying amen. Because if you keep smiling and saying amen, that means we get to go home quicker, all right? Open your Bibles to the book of Luke, chapter 19. The book of Luke, chapter 19. And while you're turning, I asked the pastor for some water. And I'll tell this real quick. I've only preached in 2 Methodist churches in my entire ministry. I am 62 years old. I've been preaching since I was 14. And I've only preached in 2 Methodist churches. And I always ask for some water because I'm on some antihistamines and so forth, and my mouth gets real dry. So when I was preaching at this Methodist church, I forgot to ask for any water. And halfway through the message, man, I needed a drink of water bad. And I looked over to my right, and there on a little table was a beautiful golden goblet. I thought, man, the Methodists do it right. This is what we give our preachers water in. And the Methodists give their pastors water in golden goblets. So I just walked over and took that goblet and got a big old drink and looked down, and 2 little ladies on the 3rd row looked as though they were going into cardiac arrest. And suddenly it dawned on me, I had just drank the baptistry. You are a little slow, but you'll catch up, all right? So So I was relieved when I saw this and I saw that. I knew we were good to go tonight. Amen. Can I have my sippy cup there, Pastor? They gave it to me in plastic tonight. Thank you. Will you stand with me in reverence to the reading of God's Word? Thank you for praying for me. I did. I really got into trouble earlier this week. I had a very, very severe reaction to some shrimp. And it was not good. So I had to go to the ER. Had to get prednisone. I quit breathing. And so this prednisone's got me sort of hacked up. And night before last, I could have sang tenor with the Cathedral Quartet. So bear with me in my voice tonight and needing some water along, but I'll do my very, very best. The book of Luke, chapter 19, and I've titled tonight's message, Jesus Passed By. Jesus passed by. And Jesus entered and passed through Jericho. And behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus, which was the chief among the publicans, and he was rich. And he sought to see Jesus, who he was, and could not for the press, because he was little of stature. And he ran before and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said unto him, "Make haste and come down, for today I must abide at your house." And he made haste and he came down and received him joyfully. And when they saw it, they all murmured, saying that he was gone to be guest with a man that is a sinner. And Zacchaeus stood and said unto the Lord, "Behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor. And if I have taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore him fourfold." And Jesus said unto him, "This day is salvation come to this house, for so much as he also is a son of Abraham." And I thank God for verse 10 tonight. "For the Son of Man, Jesus, is come to seek and to save that which was lost." Father, in Jesus' name, challenge us. And beyond the challenge, I pray you change us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. When I was a little boy, we used to go to vacation Bible school. And occasionally in Sunday school, we would sing a song that most of you in this sanctuary tonight will remember. It went something like this. Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and a wee little man was he. He climbed up in a sycamore tree for the Lord he wanted to see. And as the Savior passed his way, he looked up in the tree, and he said, "Zacchaeus, you come down, because I'm going to your house today." Do you all remember that little song? I didn't realize it, but a little boy singing that song, that I know that one day God would call me to preach and give me a message on this biblical character, a man by the name of Zacchaeus. Now, the Bible teaches us several things about him. First of all, the Bible teaches us Zacchaeus was a publican. Secondly, the Bible tells us he was very wealthy. And thirdly, the Bible makes us aware that his vocation was that of a tax collector. And I believe that it is very probable tonight that Zacchaeus simply had to go from house to house, rightfully collecting the taxes to be rendered unto his government. And tonight, in these next few moments, I'm going to ask you to join me on a brief journey as we visit four homes with Zacchaeus as he endeavors to collect taxes for the government. He arises early in the morning, and he starts down a long, dusty road. He comes to the first house of the day, and he knocks upon the door, and a gentleman responds who is blind. And Zacchaeus declares, "Sir, I am the tax collector, and your taxes are due today." And the gentleman began to weep, and he declared, "Mr. Zacchaeus, I am a blind man. I have never seen the light of day. And Mr. Zacchaeus, I cannot work as other men work. And I'd like to pay my taxes. But sir, I have no money. And I'm asking you this morning, if you would please grant me mercy for 30 days. Zacchaeus cannot imagine what it would be like to have never seen the dawn of a sunrise. But he showed pity to this blind man. And he said, "Sir, I will return in 30 days. But understand, I have a job to do. And in 30 days, when I return, your taxes must be paid." He goes to the second house of the day, and he knocks upon the door. A lady responds, and she is yellow from the top of her head to the soles of her feet. You could see that she was a very weak and sick lady. And he declares, "Ma'am, I am the tax collector, and your taxes are due this day." In brokenness and in heaviness, she declares, "Mr. Zacchaeus, I have an issue of blood. Mr. Zacchaeus, I have cancer. And to be honest, sir, all of the money that I had put aside to pay for my taxes have all been taken by my many medical expenses. I'm terminally ill. I would love to be prompt in paying my taxes, but to be honest, sir, I have no funds available this day." Zacchaeus saw that indeed she was very sick, and he declared, "Ma'am, I'm coming back in 30 days to see your neighbor just down the road. But understand, ma'am, in 30 days when I return, please understand, ma'am, your taxes must be paid." He goes to the third house of the day, and he knocks upon the door. A lady responds, and as she opens the door, she is weeping. She is wearing a ragged dress. And about that time, three little children come and huddle at her side, and they're crying because they're hungry. It has been many days since they had had a decent meal. And he's looking upon this lady and her three little children. He hears a loud, unusual noise from behind the residence. He steps to the side of the porch, and he looks around, and just behind the house is a cemetery. And there is a man who is totally nude. He is running through the cemetery. He is tearing the tombstones apart, and he is ripping his own flesh asunder. And she begins to weep and declares, "Mr. Zacchaeus, sir, that is my husband. He is possessed of demons from another world. And sir, no man can tame him, and no man can chain him. And Mr. Zacchaeus, to be honest, sir, I'm working two jobs to love and to care for and to provide for the needs of my children. But to be honest, sir, I have no money this day to pay my taxes." Zacchaeus saw that indeed this man was possessed of demons from another world. To be honest, he was not anxious to hang around, but he declared, "Ma'am, I will be back in 30 days. Understand, I am a tax collector. This is my job, and I must collect your taxes for the government. And in 30 days, when I return, regardless of the situation with your husband, your taxes must be paid." He goes to the final house of the day. He notices a spray of flowers hanging on the door, signifying that someone in the residence has died. And about that time, the door slowly opens. A lady is dressed in black, and a veil covers her face. She's weeping bitterly. And she declares, "Mr. Zacchaeus, sir, I know who you are, and I understand why you are here. And Mr. Zacchaeus, you well know I am a widow. But what you do not know is this: my only son has died. And the money that I had put aside to pay for my taxes will now be consumed by the final funeral expenses. And to be honest, sir, I have no other funds to pay for my taxes this day." Zacchaeus stands there. He is a father himself. He cannot imagine losing a child, much less an only child. And he declares, "Ma'am, I will return in 30 days. But understand, regardless of the situation here, when I return in 30 days, your taxes must be paid." Are you still with me? Say amen if you are. So very happily, those 30 days do pass. Zacchaeus arises early in the morning, and suddenly he's reminded that today he must visit four homes, that only 30 days previous he'd encountered some of the most challenging experiences of his life. He starts down that same long, dusty road. He comes to the door of the first house, and he knocks upon the door. And a gentleman responds, and there is a smile on his face. There's joy in his heart. And there is a twinkle in his eyes. And Zacchaeus declares, "I desire to see the master of the house, please." And the gentleman responds, "Sir, I am the master of this house." But he said, "Sir, I was here 30 days ago, and the master of this house was blind. I believe it was there that Bartimaeus began to sing, 'Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Sir, I was blind, but now I see.'" Amen. "See, I was blind, but that was before a man called Jesus passed by. See, Mr. Zacchaeus, I was standing on the side of the road one day, and one of my buddies cried out, 'Here comes Jesus.' Well, Mr. Zacchaeus, I'd heard of Jesus. I'd heard of his ministry. I knew he was a man of miracles. And I thought, if I could just find my way to Jesus. But you need to understand, as a blind man, I could not find my way to him. But that day in his grace, that day in his glory, when I could not go to Jesus, Jesus came to me. And he reached down into the middle of the road, and he took the dust of the earth. He spat at it. He molded it in my eyes, and he told me to go wash, and I would come seeing. And Mr. Zacchaeus, I've been seeing ever since the day a man called Jesus passed by. And Mr. Zacchaeus, remember my old CNI dog, Sam? Didn't need him anymore. Sold him to my neighbor down the road.
here's your money for your taxes. Go in peace. And Mr. Zacchaeus, I really hope you can meet Jesus someday. Wouldn't you like to have been there? Aren't you glad you're a Bible-thumping Baptist tonight? Aren't you glad you believe in all of the miracles of the Bible? Hey, I just want you to know that here is one Baptist who still believes in all of the miracles of the Bible.
Amen.
I believe Jonah got swallowed by a whale. And let me tell you how conservative I really am. Had the Bible said Jonah swallowed the whale, I would have believed that. I believe in the miracle of the parting of the Red Sea. I believe that when Moses stood there, God showed up just on time and parted the Red Sea and literally drowned the Egyptian army. Hey, I was preaching on that one night in Ohio, and a seminary professor came up to me after the service. He said, "Brother Phil, appreciate your enthusiasm. Appreciate the way you painted the picture tonight." But he said, "Brother Phil, are you not aware that theologians and historians and the guys that really understand this stuff have now concluded that where the children of Israel crossed at the Red Sea, the water was actually only 3 to 4 inches deep?" I said, "Professor, run that by me one more time." He said, "Theologians, historians have now proven that where the children of Israel crossed at the Red Sea, the water was actually only 3 inches deep." I said, "Professor, hold my mule while I have a spell, because if God drowned that crowd in 3 inches of water, it was a far greater miracle than I ever imagined." Hey, I want you to understand something tonight. Jesus passed by old blind Bartimaeus' house, and when Jesus touched his eyes, as sure as I'm standing in this pulpit tonight, he received his sight. All things passed away, and all things became new. Oh, Mr. Zacchaeus, maybe you can meet Jesus someday. He goes to the second house of the day. He knocks on the door, and a lady responds, and there's a big old smile on her face. There's joy in her heart, and there is now a fresh rose color flowing through her cheeks. And he declares, "I desire to see the master of the house, please." And she begins to weep and declares to Zacchaeus, "Sir, I am the master of this house." But he said, "Ma'am, I was here 30 days ago, and the lady who lived here had an issue of blood. The lady who lived here was eaten up with cancer. And to be honest with you, ma'am, I thought for sure you would be dead and buried by now." She said, "Oh, Mr. Zacchaeus, sit down on the porch here just for a minute. Let me tell you about the best day of my life." Some of my lady neighbor friends had come to carry me down to Walgreens to get all my prescriptions filled. And there we were standing in the middle of the road, and someone cried from a distance, "Here comes Jesus! Here comes Jesus!" And oh, Mr. Zacchaeus, I cannot explain the joy and the anticipation that arose in my heart and my spirit when I just heard the mere mention of his name. And Jesus came closer and closer and closer. And the closer he came, there was an eruption in my soul that declared, if I could just touch him, I know I would be made whole. And Mr. Zacchaeus, Jesus passed by. I was standing there on the side of the road. And when Jesus passed by, I knelt down. I reached out and I touched the hem of his garment. And when I touched the hem of the garment of the Lord Jesus Christ, Instantly, gloriously, miraculously, there was a royal blood transfusion. I was cleansed. I was made whole for no other reason save Jesus passed by. Y'all just sit there. I'll just have a spell up here by myself. Amen. I want you to understand that lady with an issue of blood was instantly, mightily, gloriously healed when Jesus passed by. Oh, Mr. Zacchaeus, maybe you can meet Jesus someday. Now, some of you looking at me right now, you know what you're saying? You're saying, Brother Phil, nice little story, but you really can't prove it happened the way you're preaching it tonight. To some extent, you are right. But on the other hand, you can't prove it didn't happen this way. I do know this. Blind Bartimaeus received his sight. I do know this. That lady with an issue of blood was gloriously and instantly healed with a royal blood transfusion when Jesus passed by. Oh, Mr. Zacchaeus, maybe you can meet Jesus someday. Here's your money for your taxes. Go in peace. He goes to the third house of the day. He knocks upon the door. Guess what? A lady responds and she is smiling. Have you ever noticed that anywhere and everywhere Jesus has been, people are happy? Yes. There's joy in their heart. There's a smile on their face. And the moral of the story tonight is if you're saved, Jesus is in your heart and the joy of Christ reigns in your soul, please notify your face. Yes. Amen. I mean, man, she is smiling. She's got on a new outfit. She's been to Dillard's. She has on a, say amen, ladies, that's the best shot you're going to have tonight. She's been to Dillard's, man. She has a new outfit. She is looking good. Hair's been fixed, makeup's just right, and about that time, three little children come and huddle at her side. Their little bellies are sticking out because they've been eating well. They have on new Tommy Hilfiger jeans. They have on new Ralph Lauren polo shirts. They have on new Nike sneakers, and about that time, a tall, dark, handsome man comes and stands at her side. She puts her arm around him. He puts his arm around her. And I bet old Zacchaeus' first impression was, man, I'm glad she got her a new man. She needed one bad. And she looks at Zacchaeus. Said, Mr. Zacchaeus, I owe you an apology, sir. You were here 30 days ago, and you saw my husband running in the cemetery. He wasn't clothed. You saw him tearing the tombstones apart. You witnessed him ripping his own flesh asunder. You saw, you witnessed that my husband was possessed of demons. I remember distinctively telling you, no man can tame him. And no man can change him. But Mr. Zacchaeus, that was before a man named Jesus. I'm about to preach myself happy. I wish somebody would help me out there. Amen. Oh, Mr. Zacchaeus, that was before a man called Jesus passed by. It was in the wee hours of the morning. Hey, we were desperate. I had done all I know to do. I had said all I knew to say. My back was against a wall. I was desperate. And in reality, I was dying physically, spiritually, and emotionally. But just in time, a man called Jesus passed by. And he knew what was going on. He recognized those demons. He did not fear them. And I have later learned that the demons in hell know who Jesus is. And at the mere mention of his name, the demons of hell tremble. And Jesus confronted those demons in my husband, and he cast those demons out of him into a herd of swine. They ran down over the mountainside below and drowned in the waiting river. And I'm here to serve notice on you, sir, and our community. I have a new husband now. My children have a new daddy now, because a man called Jesus passed by and revolutionized the life of this man. Jesus passed by. And Mr. Zacchaeus, since my husband got saved, he got a job. Is this on? Let me say that again. Since my husband got saved, he got a job. And now, not only is he the priest and the protector, but he is the provider for our family. And I want you to know, all things have passed away. All things have become new. For no other reason, Mr. Zacchaeus, but Jesus passed by our house. Mr. Zacchaeus, here's your money for your taxes. Mr. Zacchaeus, I really hope you can meet Jesus someday. He goes to the last house of the day. He knocks on the door. Seemingly at first no one's there. He knocks again. And slowly the door opens. And there's one of the most beautiful little 10, 11, maybe 12-year-old. Olive complected, brown-eyed, brown-haired boys you've ever seen. And he said, son, I'm sorry. I'm at the wrong house. And the little boy said, no, sir, Mr. Zach. Y'all slow up here in the mountains, I can tell you that. No, sir, Mr. Zach. You're not at the wrong house. You're at the right house. Matter of fact, my mama's been looking for you all morning long. And I believe old Zacchaeus would have wanted to have said, now, son, time out. I've had a long morning. Amen? Hey, son, I've seen a blind man receive his sight. I've seen a lady with an issue of blood touched by the Lord Jesus Christ. I've seen an old boy down the road possessed a demon set free. I'm telling you, I've got a full plate on me today. Son, what are you doing today? Because the lady who lived here said her only son had died. Yes, sir. That was me. I got really sick. Mama called all the neighbors, all the folks down at the church together, and we had a prayer meeting, and they prayed for me and anointed me and asked God to touch me and to heal me. But it wasn't in the plan, and it wasn't in the providence of God. Mr. Zacchaeus, my mama put me away really nice. We had the funeral, and we were coming out of the village of Nain in the procession of death. But what mama didn't realize that morning was on the other end of that dusty road was another procession.
It wasn't the procession of death. It was the procession of death.
See, we were headed toward the graveyard, but the other procession was headed toward glory. Our procession was being led by the pale horse we all call death, but the other procession was being led by the Lord Jesus Christ, the lily of the valley, the rose of Sharon, the bride and the morning star, the altogether lovely. And sir, right there in the middle of the road, we had a head-on collision.
And we learned something that day. Death and deity can't hang around the same place together very long. And Mr. Zacchaeus, Jesus stopped the procession of death. And by the way, that's why he came. Jesus said, I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. And Mr. Zacchaeus, that day, that morning, Jesus stopped the procession of death, and Jesus extended his heart to my mother. And he looked down to my mama. He said, don't cry anymore. Don't cry anymore. And Mr. Zacchaeus, after he extended his heart to my mother, he extended his hand to me. Now you got to understand, I was dead. I was just laying in the casket, minding my own business. And he touched me. And I heard him say, young man, I say unto thee, Mr. Zacchaeus, before I knew it, my heart was beating, my lungs were breathing, and up out of that casket I came. And to be honest, Mr. Zacchaeus, when Jesus raised me from the dead, it caused quite a stir in our community. Amen? Yes. Well, let me ask you something. What if your neighbor died? You went down to the funeral home, saw him in the casket, signed the register, sent flowers, took food to the house, and a couple, 3 days later, you run into him at the Walmart. I'm going to tell you, business is going to pick up around here. Amen? Mr. Zacchaeus, I was dead, but I'm not dead anymore. Because a mighty man, a miracle-working man, a man called Jesus passed by and he raised me. Folks, let me tell you something tonight. When I was 9 years old, this same Jesus, not a Hollywood Jesus, not a Harley Davidson Jesus, not a cowboy Jesus, this same Jesus passed by a little country church in East Tennessee. My eyes were blind, but he opened my eyes, and I can see tonight because of Christ. The disease of sin was as a cancer, gradually eating away and destroying my life. But Jesus cleansed me and purified me and made me white as snow. The demons of hell had rolled the dice and had gambled for my eternity. Jesus set my captive soul free. I was lost. I was dead. I was buried in the trespasses of my sins. But Jesus passed by and raised me. And I'm alive. Let me take a brief time out right here. I've seen how you South Carolina people act at football games. I've seen how South Carolina fans act at ball games. I've seen how Clemson fans act at ball games. And you know, Baptists amaze me. They will go to a football game and act like a Comanche Indian and come to the house of God and act like a wooden Indian.
I'm preaching now, I can tell you that. Amen. Hey, I'm serious. We'll go to a ball game, act like a Comanche, come to the house of God, and act like a wooden Indian.
Yes, that's right.
Now, I'm a Tennessee fan. Not a good year for that, but I'm a Tennessee fan. And a few years ago when we won the national championship, I was in Tempe, Arizona. I was at the game. We defeated Florida State. When the buzzer sounded and it was reality, Tennessee just won the national football championship. 55,000 Tennessee fans erupted and went totally insane. They were jumping up and down. They were clapping. They were giving. I mean, I'm telling you, they were falling through the bleachers. They were screaming. They were hugging. One old boy in front of me was trying to finish his hot dog, but he got so into it, he squeezed the hot dog so hard, the weenie jumped out of the bun on the woman right in front of him. I'm serious. And I looked over to my wife and I said, Brenda, it just dawned on me. Look right here, folks. I said, honey, it just dawned on me that if we can get this excited about 22 young men kicking a dead pig across a football field, we ought to be able to get excited that Jesus died for us, he was buried, he arose from the grave, and some go from daybreak, Jesus is coming back for us. We were dead, but we've been raised. Jesus passed by. And Mr. Zacchaeus, the funeral director didn't even charge us for the funeral. Amen. Here's your money for your taxes. Go in peace. Mr. Zacchaeus, I really hope you can meet Jesus. And on his way home that day, passes one of his buddies on the road. He said, Zacchaeus, I don't know if you've heard, but there's a prophet. There's a man called Jesus passing through. I believe old Zacchaeus had heard all he needed to hear. He had seen all he needed to see. Here's what the Bible says right here. He sought to see Jesus, who he was. And the Bible said that when he got to the square, he couldn't see Jesus for the press. That wasn't USA Today or Fox News. It was the people keeping him from Jesus. Look right here for just a minute. Anytime there is a desire in anyone's heart and life to get to Jesus, the enemy's going to have something or someone to keep them from Christ. And you know what Zacchaeus did? He climbed that sycamore tree because Jesus was just about to pass by. And guess what? He did. And he stopped right at the base of that tree. And he looked up in that tree. And you know what he said? Zacchaeus! Isn't that amazing? Jesus had never seen Zacchaeus before that day. Zacchaeus had never seen Jesus. And the first time Jesus lays eyes on him, he knew his name. Zacchaeus! Make haste. Come down. I'm going to your house. I don't believe Zacchaeus sat up there in the limb of that sycamore tree and said, sing one more verse, I may come down. Amen? Hey, sing one more verse. If you sing one more verse, I may come. Or the next time you come through town, we may do business. The Bible says he made haste and he came down and he received Jesus. How did he receive him? Joy.
You know what that did? That put a smile on his face. Now, sycamore trees are barkless trees. Sycamore trees don't have any bark on them at all. And one reason is, I believe he skinned that sucker so fast. And he made haste. And he came down and received him joyfully. You catch the latter part of it? The Pharisees and the scribes, the religious crowd, they began to murmur and complain. You know what they said? Can y'all believe this? They were looking around at all their, quote, religious buddies. Can y'all believe this? Check this out. Can you believe this? Jesus is going home with a sinner. Well, he's going home with a tax collector. He's going away with a robber. Can you believe this? Get the word out. Jesus is going home with a sinner. Then the Holy Spirit pins verse 10. For the Son of Man, Jesus, has come to seek and to save that which is lost. Thank God that's there. Because that includes you. And that includes me. Can I tell you a better story tonight? Let me tell you a better story. This same Jesus who touched Bartimaeus, who healed that lady with an issue of blood, this same Jesus that cast those demons out of that man from Gadarene, this same Jesus that raised that little boy from the dead, wants to go home with you tonight. And if you'll let Jesus go home with you, I promise you, he will fix whatever's wrong in your life. And my prayer is, Jesus, pass by. You challenge us, now change us. There are physical, financial, family, there are spiritual needs represented in this service tonight. And Jesus is passing by. And it's up to you. Because he's a perfect gentleman. He will only enter those homes where he's invited and where he's welcome. Let's pray together.